Thank you very much. Oh, you're very kind. Thank you. I'm so happy that came in just under an hour. I've never done one on time. And I'm going to do... Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I should have said I was going to do an encore. I don't know if this is an encore. I'm going to read something that'll make you pee in your pants. I hope it will. It makes me pee in my pants. Thank you, sir. So how about they stuck something up Bush's ass on the day my special took place? Is that... I knew I would have good luck coming to this town. And you were a great audience. I mean, usually on the night of the special, they're a little, you know, freaked out with it, but you were like a regular comedy club audience. So anyway, I want to read to you from The Purpose-Driven Life because, you know... I don't know if you know, it's the best-selling book after the Bible. It's a Christian book by Rick Warren, and I play this character on television, Bill Maher, who's single and smokes pot and, you know, thinks religion is stupid. Trust me, that's just a character. The real me is happily married to my lovely wife, Trudy, of 28 years, and our 8 Christian homeschooled children. No, I want to read this to you because I referenced it in the show when I was talking about Ashley Smith, the woman who was kidnapped and got the guy to wave the white flag. Okay, she read this book to him, The Purpose-Driven Life, and it's just an astonishing book. It's astonishing because I'm just amazed that any human being, any other person just like you and me, thinks that they could know what happens in the next world in such detail. But Rick Warren, he knows God, knows him. He talks about him like they're in the Rat Pack together. I'm not kidding. So I'm just going to read briefly from 2 of the chapters. I could read from any of the chapters. They're all the same. They're all interchangeable. I mean, I've tried to make logical sense. No. Okay. Chapter 7. The reason for everything. Exactly. Thank you for being so hip to understand how ridiculous that is. The reason for everything. That any human being could think they know that. Like if I went to India and went to the Himalayas and went to the top of the highest mountain to find the holiest, wisest man ever, and I said, what is the reason for everything? And he'd say, there's a guy, Rick, who lives in Ohio. He knows. Okay, so here we go. The reason for everything. It's all for him. The ultimate goal of the universe is to show the glory of God. It is the reason for everything that exists, including you, asshole. God made it all for his glory. Without God's glory, there would be nothing. So right away, I'm thinking, what a prick. What an egomaniacal prick. I mean, we all like to have our ass kissed, but... Everything created by God reflects his glory in some way. We see it everywhere, from the smallest microscopic form of life, which we don't necessarily believe in. To the vast Milky Way, which we're not that sure about either. In nature, we learn that God is powerful, that he loves beauty, that he enjoys variety. Well, come on, a powerful man like that? I mean, they throw themselves at him. Of course he's going to enjoy a little variety. I mean, he can't help it. I mean, you can't judge him on the same... It's like Mick Jagger, you know. I mean, you know, you can't expect him to be faithful. Enjoys variety, is organized. That's so important in a God. I hate an unorganized God. I hate a God who's like, oh, fuck, what was I going to do on the 6th day? Create the night? Or did I do that already? I had a sticky on my computer.
is organized and is wise and creative. Typical Capricorn, I must say. I don't mean to brag, but I'm a Capricorn also, so it's... All right, and one more little chapter, chapter 9. What makes God smile? The smile of God is the goal of your life, which makes sense because we learned in the other chapter that he's all that. Since pleasing God is the first purpose of your life, your most important task is to discover how to do that. The Bible says, figure out. Yeah, the Bible says, figure out. Figure out what will please Christ and then do it. Do it. Do it. Do it. Fortunately, the Bible gives us a clear example of a life that gives pleasure to God. The man's name was Noah. Sammy Davis Noah. Man's name. In Noah's day, the 50s. His heyday. In Noah's day, the entire world had become morally bankrupt. Everyone lived for their own pleasure, not God's. God couldn't find anyone on earth interested in pleasing him, so he was grieved and regretted making man. You know, because he's God, so he has a lot of second thoughts. God became so disgusted with the human race that he considered wiping it out. But you know what? He called a timeout. He knows he's a hothead. He's like, no. Okay, I'm okay. But there was one man who made God smile. The Bible says Noah was a pleasure to the Lord. Like a good steak, a pleasure, just a pleasure. God said, this guy brings me pleasure. I swear to God. This guy brings me pleasure. He makes me smile. I'll start over with his family. Because Noah brought pleasure to God, you and I are alive today. How about a hand for Noah, ladies and gentlemen? Noah, we're alive today because of him. That is a gentleman. That is nice. That is picking up the check for the whole table. All right. In conclusion, God smiles when we love him supremely. Who wouldn't? Noah loved God more than anything else in the world, even when no one else did. Yeah, God had some bad years. It's not all tits and champagne in that business. No one else did. The Bible tells us that for his entire life, Noah consistently followed God's will and enjoyed a close relationship with him. This is what God wants most from you, a relationship. I knew it. God is a chick. Thank you very much. You were great. What a pleasure. Thank you.